it's almost buffoonery, like that kind of, those kind of antics. Like, it's not even no WWE shit. I mean, maybe it is. Maybe that's what they're going for with that. But that's not a good look. That's not a, like, a good look is like the X Games, where you got niggas just trying to kill each other, kill themselves, jumping off of huge ass fucking dirt hills and shit. And that turns into worldwide Olympic competition that's regulated. And nobody's punching nobody in the face when they get a bad score. None of that kind of shit. I mean, a completely wild and carefree thing like BMX dirt bike racing or whatever, or jumping and doing tricks, turns into an Olympic regulated competition. Now, how come there's no, how come B-boying is not part of Olympics at this point? How come, you know, there aren't certain skill sets in hip-hop, fucking DJ competition? I mean, it don't gotta be a part of the Olympics, but I'm just saying, how come it's not a world recognized thing that everybody sees and that everybody looks at? Right now, only about 20% of the people even watch any of these competitions, whether it's MCing, B-boying, graffiti DJing. I mean, less for graffiti. It's probably like maybe 10 or 5% of hip hoppers actually see that shit. All right. Beatboxing, same thing. 5 or 10% of hip hoppers actually see any of those competitions. But if they were to see any of the best competitions, they would be entertained by them. And of course, once you get the little backstories and all the little details, like you do with any Olympic athlete or any type of competition, you start giving the backstory of the two people competing. Once you do all that, of course it would be interesting to people. Yes, to see a beatbox competition. Yes, to see a DJ competition. If you knew what all the tricks were, like if you got somebody that was breaking, oh, this was the, you know, this is what he's doing right now. You know, he's whatever techniques he, oh shit, he's using an old school crab technique. You know, what is that? What is he doing? And somebody's breaking it down. That would give a whole new level of entrepreneurship that would go right along with that. But, you know, that's just how things are. And, you know, before I get into some more of this freestyle, you know what? I was remembering something, because, you know, it was Throwback Thursday yesterday. So I was remembering something, and I don't know how many times this has been done, but it's sort of worth mentioning. All right, that there's only been a few times when good distorted vocals have been used well in a rap song, but it's such a good technique. It's such a, you know, see, the, you know, one time that I remember is obviously in 1994 with the Boogie Monsters, when they did Thresholds of Negative Stress. And you remember the distorted mic sound that the one dude was using? I think his name was Vex or something like that. That just sounds so good. You know what I'm saying? Just as a hip hop person, I just was thinking about that the other day too. And I don't know, what do you think about that? I mean, because of course people are gonna go back to remembering the first time they heard that. All right, they're going to go back to the first time they heard that, which was like in 1992. All right, and they heard it on here. Let me see if I can bring it up.
Like a mob and God, I got that. The perception and protection. Get pops.
That ain't freestyle. I'm not talking about the record. I actually just motherfucking answered the door. But look, man, check it out. You know, I wanted to go on one more thing real quick. And again, it's something that I talked about before. And that is hip-hop won. All right, people don't realize that hip-hop actually proved its point already. We never had a celebration. There wasn't no big party saying, oh shit, hip-hop won, we're successful, blah, blah. None of that really happened. There was no big celebration or anything. You know, everybody just still thinks we're in the struggle. And we're actually not. Hip-hop is actually not in the struggle no more. Okay, I mean, just look. Look at these cats. I mean, look at the cats that made their lives off of hip-hop. Totally off of hip-hop. There's cats that have $500 million now because of hip-hop. I mean, isn't that a good thing? I would say so. I mean, but not just that. It's been proven that hip-hop is a worldwide, international culture of people that share in the acknowledgement of certain elements and certain basic ideologies. Certain things about rawness that we accept. Certain things about originality we used to accept that a lot of people don't fully understand anymore. Have to question whether or not they're actually for real hip hoppers. Or if they're just rap fans. A lot of rap fans nowadays. You know, been losing some of our hip hop people. And a last thing that I even actually wanted to say was that even though we've won, the oppression and the struggle continues because of the loss of culture. All right, now, if hip hop was really its thing, it would encompass not just the youth, which is sad to say. I'm starting to think that it's one of the lies that hip hop has been telling, saying that hip hop is a youth culture. I mean, hip hop sort of started out and it was embraced by the youth. Okay, but any real culture is going to embrace everybody. Any for real culture is going to be embraced by everybody. And you got to keep it real. Everybody that was supporting and pioneering hip hop wasn't a kid, you know, when they started out or when they were doing things that were influential to hip hop. Right? And even now, the main people are like all over 30, really. They like 27 and up, like from Nicki Minaj and them all on up. They are all like in their late 20s and 30s. They not kids. You know what I'm saying? And that's a myth because in reality, the social economic elite want us to embrace a youth culture and a continual desire for newness so that we forget the past. And some of those same tried and true tricks that were used in the past to swindle people can be used again. Okay. So, hip-hop has a whole generation of people, the first generation hip-hoppers that are not kids, all right, they're in their 40s and 50s maybe, all right, the first generation hip-hoppers, a lot of them that grew up and created and supported hip-hop turned away from hip-hop now. because it's too irrelevant to them. So that whole marketplace of people that own homes and cars and businesses and, you know, people that are productive members of society, they're being turned away from modern day hip hop, and all that money just walking right out of the door and going into gospel or, you know, some old evangelistic type preacher. They giving them, you know, they taking all your money and giving it to him. You know, they not spending it with hip hop anymore. They might, you know, buy a pair of sneakers every once in a while, or I don't know, maybe, because, you know, people don't buy music really that much anymore. So I can't say that. Maybe they'll go to an old school concert once in a while if they come around. But that whole audience is not being satisfied. That whole audience that helped the first generation hip hoppers that helped create hip hop. Damn, forget it. The first generation and beyond, where it's like the 35 and up that helped create what you see as hip hop right now, aren't really supported by hip hop and aren't really encouraged to participate in hip hop right now. You guys say, why is that? Why is it like that? You know? Why are we not utilizing that? But that's just one of those amazing questions that we contemplate sometimes when we think about hip hop. All right. Again, when we talk on here, this is just, you know, just to kill some time, maybe kill a half an hour's worth of time for you if you ever listen to this. You know, but at the same time, maybe it sparks a thought in your mind. All right. Otherwise, it's more of so of a journal and a record about the state of hip hop as it's going on. Right, so that's what it is, man. I'm your man right here, Curtin ICE. You can check me out on shadesradio.com if you're listening to this so far. If you've listened to up till now, you know, if you want any more of this, go to the live stream channel. I got over 12 hours worth of hip hop goodness, classic, exclusive, for real hip hop, made, most of it made during the golden era, but we got new shit too on there. We got a little bit of new shit, you know, especially new conversations and shit like that too. I mean, I got my Immortal Technique, that's all new, that wasn't done in the 90s, but there's a whole bunch of that shit, you know, gospel of hip hop and all of that came out, all of the touring and shit that was relevant at that time, all of that shit is on there. You know what I mean? But of course, the classics, CDS, you got the whole version of Controlled Dangerous Substance, Shades of Hip Hop. All right. Came out in 1998. You got The Cypher on there. And I'm not even going to go into what's on those tapes. You just got to go check it out. Find out for yourself if you haven't already seen it. If you're one of the hip hoppers that hasn't seen some of that material yet. You know. But if you are a true hip hopper, you would have to have seen something from the Shades of Hip Hop catalog. But this is that material in its full glory. All right? So go check that out on the live stream. You can catch that on shadesradio.com or even on hiphopbiz.net. Right? Just go to the front page and you'll see the live stream catalog up in there. All right? And in the meantime, go to amazon.com if you want to check out the book, Shades of Hip Hop Underground Scene, Photo Journal Retrospective, and Hip Hop Know What I'm Saying. All right? That's what it is. I'm your man right here, Curtin ICE. To the next time, all right?